Elections are about this a lot of the time. I don't know if the one in the middle is about an election, but I just had to put it in. Yeah. So elections might all be about kissing babies and being out on the hustings, but really, elections are moments. They're not the only moment, but they're an important moment. That's when we can focus our, the community focuses attention on the direction that we're going to head in as a nation for the next few years. It's where new ideas can be tested and floated, and hopefully we can get commitments from the process of a contested space. But I think elections are also quite tricky because it is a contested space. So there's an adversarial thing going on in elections where someone can say, that's right, and someone else says, no, that's wrong. And we have to be very careful that we aren't just left with someone saying, this is an ambitious set of policies that we need, and so, and the other side or other sides saying it can't possibly be done. So it's quite similar to the NDIS campaign, which is that we don't want people to say no immediately. We want people to champion our issue. We want the major parties to say, me too, and someone to say, well, I've got this idea, and they say, well, me too. That's where we want to be this year. So I guess why we'd work on this election is, as Paul said, this is just not going to work. We've got a new guy running the country. He's got a record on taking action to some extent on climate change. And he's an innovation fiend. He's, you know, teched up and talking about, you know, as I said yesterday, agility, innovation, knowledge nation kind of stuff. But we are not actually sure what they're going to do. We've seen a whole lot of rhetoric change, which is important in terms of leading the country and providing business and industry confidence. And that those kinds of sentiments that we're hearing matter, but we haven't seen a lot of tangible action yet. So that's really why we'd look at this election. And when we look at this election, we really need to take into account the situation that we're in at the moment. So first thing you're doing when you're doing campaigning work is you think, oh, let's do some analysis. So the kind of reality at the moment is that on a two-party preferred basis, the coalition is ahead, and Malcolm Turnbull is extremely popular as the new Prime Minister. He enjoys more than, you know, 50 to 60% of popular support as preferred leader amongst Green voters, which I found quite surprising, actually. And this is a poll from News Poll from the end of January, which demonstrates that. I'm happy to take people through the figures in more detail a bit later. And this is an Essential poll from a couple of weeks ago, or a week or so ago, which talks about, it's reflecting the same trends. Polls aren't everything, but polls do actually provide a bit of it takes a temperature a little bit on how things are travelling. So that's the kind of reality that we're in. There's also other factors. You know, we've seen ministerial scandals crop up over summer and lots of ministers resigning or, you know, moving to the back bench. We've seen a change in the leadership of the National Party with Barnaby Joyce. We've seen a couple of long-standing ministers saying they will retire at the election. And then there's all the kind of muttering of leadership speculation that's starting to crop up around the ALP. So, you know, at the moment, it looks like, you know, the election's a bit of a foregone conclusion, but never say never or never think that you know what's going to happen in politics, because no matter what someone says from all of their vast experience, yeah, they're often not right. So, but what we do know, what we are absolutely rock solid on, is that we have a constituency of people who've made that personal investment to put those solar panels on their rooftops, and they are prepared to act on it. That's why you're all here in this room, in a small number, but we're representing a lot of people and we can access those people. Just to give you a bit of a sense of that, here's some Queensland electorates that where people in this room have come from to the conference this weekend. And you'll see that there's very slim margins, or even not quite so slim margins in the case, of Peter Dutton. But compared to the proportion of solar ownership in that electorate, It's phenomenal. So I think the challenge here is not that we don't have enough people that could potentially be interested in our issues. We know that we do. We know that people are on side with renewable energy in general, and people love solar specifically. So we've got that on our side. It's probably just a matter of going out and talking to all of those people. So let's get back to the second thing you do when you're doing an election campaign is setting out objectives. And these are our broad objectives for the coming year when it comes to the federal campaign. We, as John said earlier today, we need to define what victory looks like for our issue, which is getting that support from all major parties and independents for our policy agenda, which is grounded in 100% renewable energy as recommended by the Homegrown Power Plan. The second thing we really need to do is help ensure that the narrative across the year doesn't become compromised by those vested interests that want to hold solar back. So we're really looking at making sure the conversation in the media, in the public, in the parliament, amongst the industry is all talking about transition to 100% renewable energy with active, involved consumers engaged in that is a given. We don't want to, you know, say, could it be done? Is it possible? Will baseload be able to provide electricity that is continuous and reliable and efficient and affordable? We want to make sure that that's assumed and reinforced across the year. We want to also put pressure in local communities where we can really hone ourselves down to the best places where we can go and have those conversations that will put pressure on individual sitting MPs and candidates that will allow them to champion our issues in those local electorates. So taking the personal stories from you and the people that you will work with in your electorates to do that, and really go and put pressure on people who oppose that policy agenda, but then allow people to take up the fight and become champions as well. And then our last objective, our last objective is to grow our movement. So it's not just about, you know, what we go for during the year, but we need to be able to lock in our victories after we win. And so building our movement in terms of the number of solar citizens, our skills amongst our volunteers, but actually building our knowledge, skills and commitment so that we can see it through and ensure that the legislation that makes that policy real happens. So typical election campaign has four phases. We prepare, then we get out there. We go crazy during election time for the 6-week campaign period, and then we go and make sure that we win after we win. So preparation, part of why we're here this weekend is to get that work done. So the fact that you're here going to masterclasses, building your knowledge, and is really, really super important. So that's a really essential part of the work that we're doing over the next, this early phase in the campaign. And also doing that policy work, that important policy piece is there as well. So more preparation that we would be like you to take from this weekend is to go and map your community, your local electorates, and Dan and Ellen will be taking you through an exercise in doing that in a little while. Part of our preparation is also the polling work that I talked to a little bit yesterday. So just seeing and like taking the temperature of where the nation's at on particular policies. And to talk you through this in a little bit more detail than I did yesterday, we're seeing that Australians are more likely to back very specific asks that are informed by the policy work that Miriam and Nikki have been doing, but then also kind of how we can articulate those complex policy documents into appealing things that people can make sense of and get behind and support. So this kind of the idea of a commitment to invest in large-scale solar and wind, you know, 59% support, that's pretty healthy. This policy to gradually transition Australia to 100% renewable energy in 14 years, you know, majority support. A policy to ensure that solar is installed on every home that's suitable and on buildings like hospitals and schools. Everyone thinks about health and education in elections, so that's why the hospitals and schools are in there, 63%. And a policy that helps people to get battery storage so solar can be used around the clock has, you know, 60%. It's not just 60% of people support it. 60% of people think that they are more likely to vote for a party which adopts these policies. So it's quite a powerful proposition. So that's part of the preparation that we'll be doing, is looking at more research like this on a national basis, but also honing down into particular target geographic areas that we will be focusing on. Now, the second phase is outreach, and that means two things. Early on in election years, it's very important to obviously reach out to your local team members if you're in a Solar Citizens team, reaching out to others within other networks and environmental organisations so we can build those connections, but then also reaching out to the MP in your electorate, going and seeing that person, having a chat to their staff, going and meeting the candidates who are running as well. Really make the invitation early, talk about what we're going to do, and then they'll see at the end of the election campaign, oh, those guys said they were going to go and campaign and lock in renewables in this electorate. Oh, look, they did it. We better pay attention to them after election day. This is an example of an outreach tactic that we've used before. Lindsay talked about the 100% renewable survey that collected 14,000 surveys a few years ago. This is another example that a number of people here took part in around the Senate, the crossbench Senate work to protect the renewable energy target. So community surveys were designed at a smaller scale, and we surveyed people outside the electorate office of the senators that were targeted in most cases, and then delivered those community surveys to the senators. And it was really pivotal and very important work that helped guarantee the support of those crossbench senators in defending the renewable energy target and those other important federal policies. So at the moment, we're thinking this will be one of the key outreach tactics in target electorates. So doing that and then surveying over a longer period of time, then taking that to community forums or to candidates' events during the actual election period. Now, the election itself, this is some pictures from the Queensland state election most recently, where we have our solar warriors here. You might recognise Jace here, got into the spirit there. He's looking very warrior-like. And this is a bit fuzzy, this photo, but it's the Sunshine Coast team did a fantastic visual action down at the beach as part of that campaign as well. So in terms of the election campaign itself, there's a couple of things that we would like to run. The first thing is that in target electorates where we've got established teams, good connections with other environment and climate organisations that are also campaigning, we will be working on a series of tactics that really raise the temperature in that electorate, including, depending on what's relevant in that electorate, community forums, candidates forums, visual colour and movement kind of tactics that really draw the attention of local media and getting in the local media. But then more broadly, we want people, as we always do at Solar Citizens, to be able to participate in our campaign tactics wherever they might be. So if people want to be able to go and hold their own candidates forum around solar, we will provide all the resources and tools online that will allow that to happen. So you get instructional guides, all of the materials that you'll need, and support from our organisers. So then after we win, you know, it's kind of tricky because we need, at the moment, we know that there's a few voices within the parliament that are very anti and quite ideologically driven in terms of their opposition to renewable energy and action on climate change. So at the moment, we're really looking at how we can place enough pressure on those guys to get them on board with our policy agenda. And that's mainly driven because the election seems to be, at the moment, a bit of a foregone conclusion. But we need to be ready to be able to shift quite quickly if the race tightens up, or if, you know, we're getting more policy action than we expect or less out in terms of commitments from particular parties or politicians. So we need to be able to pivot quickly. So we have general phases and a suite of tactics that we'll be rolling out across the year. And it'll be up to you as to how much you elevate that in your community or what you might decide to do with that. But after we win everything that we are campaigning for, which I'm sure you're all looking forward to on election day, we intend to go and take that straight to Canberra again. Our vision is to try and fundraise so we can have a 2 or 3 day lobbying exercise in Parliament where solar citizens come from all over the country and lobby all 150 lower house representatives. Now, it's a big goal. We'll see if we can do it. I'm sure that with all of you in the room working together, we can do that. So you're probably all wondering, but the other bit of speculation that's floating around is what if there's an early election? Well, apart from babies all over Australia reacting like this once they hear about it, it's just so good, isn't it? What we have a rapid response election plan ready. We're ready to pivot to that if we need to, and we will launch our campaign the day that they do. So that's kind of it in a nutshell. I hope you're excited about what's ahead. We are still finalising our priority electorates that we want to work in, but because you're here today and you come from lots of different places, Dan, I'd like to invite Dan and Ellen up now to take you through an exercise in mapping your local area and how you can actually use that information to get your campaigns for solar going on the ground. Thanks.
Hi everyone, how are we going? Everyone feeling good? Yay. So Claire's just taken us through our plan to get us to that. We did something I want everyone to cast their minds back to Queensland about 13 months ago. We had a premier in place in Queensland who had some interesting ideas about solar and renewable, including a commitment to rolling back the feed-in tariff if Mr. Newman was elected again. Now, our Queensland team were not going to stand by and watch that happen. So we ran a very quick election campaign up here. I actually wasn't working at Solar Citizens at this time. So there's two people I'd like to invite to come and tell us a little bit about it. Rhonda and Jason, who's our community organiser in Queensland. Can we please make them very welcome? So you guys need a microphone?
You guys go stand over there. I'll stand over here.
So, Rhonda, tell me about what happened during the Queensland election campaign. What was the first thing that happened when the election was called?
Basically, we rallied all our troops. We went out. We did door knocking, markets. Basically, just tried to get as many people together with the same initiatives and get them to sign petitions, all that sort of stuff, to let all the local politicians know that this was a serious election issue and that we could pretty much, make it an issue for the state thing.
So the first thing we do is we grew the movement because we need to go and sign people up and get people involved in the movement to go out there and make it happen. We then found out where the politicians stood, and we did that by producing a solar scorecard. I might ask Jason to tell us about how we went at getting the solar scorecard filled out.
Well, to get the solar scorecard done, we got in contact with every candidate and asked their position on 5 key policies. And
our slideshow didn't corrupt it on the way in, so that's been fun, but I remember them if you lose them.
Yeah, so one of them was a fair price on solar. One of them was a trial on battery storage. One of them was a million solar homes, and we just made that up. We were like, we need 5 is better than 4. What should we go? Let's go for a million solar homes. And the ALP adopted that as a policy. Like, we were like, what are you guys going to do on a million solar homes? They're like, yeah, we're doing that for sure. And they won. I don't think they expected to win. And so, what else was it? An interdiscriminatory fees and a renewable rate.
To protect the renewable energy target. Yeah. And we won. And it happened. And the first thing we did after the election was we asked for a commitment from Anastasia Palaszczuk, and we
asked for a letter, and we have a letter which I had to display for you, which basically wrote back with the current government committing to all the things that we'd asked for. So Claire took us through the steps. We grew the movement, we worked out where our candidates stood, and then we campaigned on that, and then we locked in the win. And we locked in the win, and we've continued to lock in the win. Reece and Bruce and a few of our other team members met with Mark Bailey recently, who's the energy minister up here, to remind him of those commitments based on fixed prices and a million solar homes and other things like that, because we make sure that we kept that together. Thank you very much, Jason and Rhonda. That was great. We're running out of time, so I'm going to rush us through. Quick one's a good one. So there are a series of steps we need to take to win an election, and now it's up to you guys to start to work on that. So we've created a little exercise for you, which we're going to ask you to do. Oh, it's a bit loud. Sorry, apparently I've got a really loud voice. Who knew? We've created a little exercise we're going to take you through in electorates that we've picked. I understand not all of you are from the same electorate, so we've been a bit creative with where we've placed you. But we're going to teach you how to do a few things, and I'm going to ask Ellen to take you through that exercise.
Okay, great. Well, Dan's going to get you into groups according to your electorates, and then we're going to have a sheet that we're going to go through here. You would have heard Lindsay Sutar's amazing speech yesterday where she talked about the number of solar homes and the margin and the relationship between those two numbers. And I ran a workshop yesterday and people were really excited about that prospect and structuring their election campaigning around that, and that's certainly something that Solar Citizens has done in the past. So Dan's going to hand out these sheets and get you into groups, but essentially they've got some information for you on there already about the margin, the difference between the two parties, so what's necessary in order to win, the number of solar households, and then also the votes that the other party's got. And then there's a range of prompts that we want you to go through that we are hoping are going to structure your election campaigning in your particular electorate. And that's about what do you know about the MP, about who influences them and what their position on solar is, how you would connect with people who are solar owners in your electorate, and then what tactics you might use, given some of the examples that Solar Citizens has done in the past, to really build pressure around the issue of solar in your electorate. So hopefully that should be pretty straightforward. Dan's going to help with getting facilitators and getting you into groups, and you will have someone with you who will understand a bit more about the process as well. So thanks.
We let you guys go for about an extra 10 minutes because the conversation seemed to be really great. People seem to be getting really excited. People seem to be getting really into it. Of course, this needs to be the start of the conversation, not the end of a conversation. But I did ask groups to, I hope everyone's back. People might have snuck off. I did ask people to designate someone from their group to report back to us. So the report back has two key components. One is to very quickly give us, I call it an elevator conversation. So say you and I are in an elevator, we're going from level 1 to level 5, you've got to in about a minute, explain really quickly the three most exciting things that came from your discussion. And I would also like the person to report back to come and have a chat to me at lunchtime so we can make sure we gather that sheet and gather that information and we can really put this forward into the plans that we work on in the future. Does that sound okay to everyone? So I'll roam with the mic. Can you guys hear me without a mic?
Yeah. Excellent.
No problems at all. Okay, so who do we have from Dixon? Yeah. At the back, of course you're going to make me run, aren't you? I feel like I'm in a game show.
Thanks.
What's your name?
My name's Carl. I'm from the Australian Conservation Foundation.
Hi, Carl.
Hey, so we looked at Dixon. None of us actually lived in Dixon, but we had a little bit of knowledge on it. The current margin in Dixon is 6.7% to the LNP, with Peter Dutton as the sitting member. Of the roughly 85,000 or so votes in the last election, and the 14,717 solar households, we estimated that there was about 32.9% of the electorate who has solar homes, which is quite strong and gives us a good basis for the election campaign in the suburb, in the electorate. So we went through some tactics around what we would look at and how we could get more of a support base for solar. It has a high percentage of solar homes. We think it is a strong election issue. The first step would be finding local leaders, looking at door knocking, phone banking, doing market stalls, local research to understand people's preferences in the area through groups that already exist. So connecting with local groups is a strong element there as well. We'd also have to look at the new Labor incumbent. There's no Labor Party candidate at the moment in Dixon, and also the Greens. So our knowledge was a little bit limited, but that's what we basically got from the 20 minutes. Thanks.
Well done, Dixon.
Ford. Who did Ford? Here we go. Who's going to do it?
No, you.
Okay, we're going to break it up. So top three things, hard to narrow it down. Highlights for me was the suggestion that we really get involved with the local solar installers because they would have, phenomenal customer information lists. If they weren't able to supply that, then they could at least help us with some of the other tactics that we had, particularly, perhaps talking to some of the bigger commercial or spaces where there is solar. So that was a highlight for me.
Another nifty little idea we had was that we could, as far as awareness raising and recruiting people, we could go and encourage a solar company to have a display at a local sporting event. They could have their solar panels out there working, and you can have your scorecard for the game and then also a scorecard up for the solar panels to show people how much power it's generated just throughout the course of the game. And people could come and charge their phones at the same time off the panels just to start the conversations going. And then another one we liked was having local open solar houses days. And so there might be some local residents who are willing to open their home to people to come and see, not necessarily clamber around on their roof, but to understand how a solar setup works and not feel like it's such a daunting thing to install, and to hear how much money that household has saved just with their own setup.
Excellent. Thank you very much, guys. Round of applause, please.
Petrie. Oh. Do you guys remember The Price is Right? Excuse me. Hi, thanks for coming. Good to see you.
Anticipation. There you go.
Hi, I'm Garth, and basically what we did is much of what these other two people have done is go through all the ideas that we could come up with to get some information to our local member so that he, in this particular instance, he could look at how he could take that information to the party room, because that's where the change is going to occur, not so much at the individual level, but at the party room. So he can go there with ammunition. So we'll be looking at things like the solar information that solar group here can get together to present data to this to the local politician. We unfortunately do have a situation where all the neoliberals within the coalition at the moment do control what sits in the party room, thus control what sits in the policies, and we need to be able to start nibbling away at that to have some changes in the party room and that therefore the policy platforms. Some of the things that we did to help get some information across to people would be door knocking, phone banking, shopping centre malls, market stalls, etc., etc., where the idea is to actually engage in conversations with people to show them that there is potential for them as individual consumers in having solar. And there is some benefit to them in the environment by having solar. So it's a lot of conversation. So the two fronts were basically individual information to electors in that particular electorate, saying what benefit it is to them so that they can become more interested in solar energy. And then the second one is to actually have the local member take a lot of information and supported by that by those electors so that he gets re-elected to the party room for further discussion, et cetera, et cetera. One of our big problems at the present moment, of course, the Turnbull government, Malcolm Turnbull, is a bit hamstrung with the position he's adopted to support all the Abbott policies, et cetera, et cetera, so he could actually get into the position of Prime Minister, and that's going to continue for some time, so we need to change the members' view through the party room. Thank you.
Fantastic. Thank you very much. Now, because I know who these guys are, I'm going to say, who's going to report back from Hindmarsh? Deirdre. Deirdre, you know?
Quick one. Hi, guys. So, lots of great ideas here that came from the group. First thing was get the latest near map data on where all the solar panels are in the electorate so that we can focus on that. The other thing is to partner up with other organisations, ACF, AYCC, all of those others, so that we don't duplicate and we don't want voter fatigue. So that we'll focus on this, you focus on that. And Alex, where's Alex? Alex said he wants to do the coastal stuff because there's all sorts of issues about rising water areas in that coastal area. The other thing is target specific groups within the communities. The Greek community is very strong in that area. Can you hear me? Is that better? So we've also got Nick Xenophon Factor in that area because he's Greek, and even though his person who's going to be going for that party is not Greek, there's still a strong pull for that area. Local solar businesses, owners, perhaps put together a solar forum and it would be called the Solarbration. And the phone banking, the door knocking. But the celebration, just getting back to that, it would also be, you know, with bringing in the businesses so that local people could find out how they could improve it. And also those people who don't have solar, how we could support those. And then the one that Steve came up was honk if you like solar, but that would be right near the sitting MP's office. So he would hear it and would have a honkometer.
Honk if you like solar, that's great. Warringa, here we go.
Hi, Warringa is a New South Wales electorate. It's held by a guy we all know and love, Mr. Rabbit. On a margin of 15.3%, with only 2,000 solar households, so we gave up. No, seriously. We wanted to know how many solar citizen members there are in the electorate because that would form the basis of our action group. To find out how many, find out the composition of the local council in terms of the number of green councillors and whether there have been any electorate-specific surveys that would tell us what the views are of the people on various social issues, other NGOs that are active in related areas. We wanted to identify a solar homeowner and a solar business owner for photo ops and interviews and so on. It's a beach culture, so you know, we would have to take that into consideration and look at local council data vulnerability to climate change and ABS data on incomes, home ownership, apartments, and various other factors. In terms of looking at what we know about the Member of Parliament, in this case it was pretty easy because we all did, but normally you'd look at the parliamentary website, Hansard, donations there have been to their political campaigns, their personal background, university and so on. In terms of tactics, we're looking basically at building community support rather than trying to convince the member in this case that he's wrong. get pledges from the other candidates. There's a disproportionately high level of green voters in that community. So that would be an interesting affiliation. We're going to run a meet the candidates forum, and also find out what their key influences were saying about the issue of 100% renewables and climate change and so on.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Warringa. Okay, so what we've got left is Bonner, Deakin, Brisbane. Have I forgotten anyone? Fairfax and New England. Okay. Really quick, elevator conversation. So 1 minute, because we're running out of time and we're all getting hungry. Who's doing Fairfax?
Brilliant. Hello, my name is Luciano from Project Brainstorm. We decided that the first thing to do is to make sure that Fairfax is held by good old Clive Palmer, who happened to win his election. He won by 37 votes, so very slim margin, and he's been identified as a dead man walking. It's very likely, on the latest poll results, that Ted O'Brien, who's the member from the Liberals, is on 50%. The Labor candidate, his name is Scott Anderson. He's 27%. The Greens have got about 10%. So it looks like Liberals are probably, at this stage, they've got the box seat. So the idea was to approach them and come up with a scorecard on a sliding scale to see where the parties sit as far as solar goes, to put solar on the agenda and to go to 100% renewables, to look at some of the likely objections and people saying, but that's not possible. So to actually have case studies and stories and technical experts that can explain why it is possible. We had a couple of engineers in the group, which was very handy to help bolster that case. The most important thing that we identified was that we have to have stories, because if stories and narratives are the things that people identify with, and the politicians themselves need to tell the story as to why a particular agenda item is worth pursuing and how many votes they can bring in. The tactics we would use to focus and build a solar movement, it would be the focus on jobs, and in Fairfax unemployment is a particular problem, informing people of the issues, both of the media issues and educating them on the technical side with disruptive technologies that's now available. And how we would, who we would bring if we were to meet the minister would be to bring our own personal stories, to bring a well-respected community leader and technical experts and solar installers along with the case studies. Okay, that's it.
Excellent. Thank you very much. Bonner. All right, good, because I need the exercise.
Hi, I'm Steve. I don't really like speaking to microphones, but here we go. All right, so we had Bonner. No one here lives in Bonner, so I kind of got the straw. It's Bayside. There's a 3.7% margin to Ross Vista. Our idea was through infographics that we would try and find something that was easy to read, easy to comprehend, understand, and easy to share, something that you can just take a picture of and send it to your friends, send it wherever you like. On the infographics, we were looking for, basically some good info, and that also double as a pledge card too. We'd also try and talk with the candidates in the area, figure out what it was that they particularly felt about solar, and then publish their opinion on the infographic. Our other idea was to target people's hip pocket and go for an opportunity cost on if they had solar with the money that they would save, not so much putting a number with a dollar sign in front of it, but more putting it into a local's perspective for them, which was how many more times can you go to Stratty, and other kind of like holiday stuff like that. Also the idea, someone else mentioned it just before with regards to trades and jobs in the area, would be with the money that you save off of solar, that's more money for the local economy, so take that as far as you can. And what else we got? Our target was basically for local sports teams, community groups, and try and get people to, like, within the area, within the community, to start talking about it. Once we've got the conversation there, we can, you know, ask what questions we need, and yeah, that's about it.
Excellent. Thank you very much. And we've got two more, Deakin in Brisbane, is that right? Yep. Okay. Ooh, okay. All right. I need to, like, I probably didn't think this out very much, the walking around.
Yeah, Deakin is in Melbourne. My name's David O'Neill. Look, we've been doing some groundwork around Deakin. The Australian Solar Council actually targeted Deakin when they ran their mobile campaign around Australia, and the local member who's to the right of the Liberal Party, a guy called Michael Sukar, was a no-show. But things change. I've gone to see him, I've gone to see the Labor candidate, and Michael Sukar believes he's got a story to tell around renewables, and he thinks he was just stood up for the forum that was previously organised. Look, we're working with Environment Victoria and the ACF in that constituency. We think Michael Sukar's right-wing position is going to go against him to a point. And, you know, our initial approach, other than we've established the candidates want to engage around renewables, is to move around the constituency stations, fairs, etc. They have markets where these guys show up and have a short survey as a lead into potentially a longer conversation with their people. So we can go back to these guys and say, look, you know, you've got a strong level of interest around your electorate. They're happy to work in debate with each other. They're happy to be in forums. It's just getting our facts straight first.
Fantastic. Thank you, David. Thank
you. And last but definitely not least is Brisbane.
Cool. So, yeah, in Brisbane we have Teresa Gambaro, who decided to invite Lord Monckton to her family restaurant. And against her in the next election is Paddy O'Neill, who's running on 100% running on supporting renewable energy for Labor. So things that haven't been mentioned is basically use examples already in Australia and around the world that are going for 100%, so Lismore, Yarkandandah, Byron Bay, etc. And then having an action where in Brisbane Square they got rid of all the grass a few years ago and it's now really hot. It's like a cold European city square and it's really hot. So going in there with solar panels and holding them up so you can provide shade, etc. And then having lock the gate style type signs, so little yellow signs saying solar household. And then the last one was the question of engaging support for big solar community renewables and remote solar, and then does Solar Citizen, because we're all mostly around householders, is that part of our agenda, you know, having that debate whether it is. So maybe there's a new organisation to be started called Solar Businesses.
Thank you very much. And I forgot New England. Okay.
Hi, I'm Emma Stiltz from New England. So our local member is Barnaby Joyce. yeah, it's great. So he has a margin of 7%, and currently we're not sure if Tony Windsor will run against him, but if not, it's a solar installer from Armidale called Rob Tabor. So we would hope to get the 7,535 houses that have solar in our electorate to get a survey to them and to show how much support solar has in the New England and take it to Barnaby and say, do you want these people to support you? If so, what can you do for us? And if you don't support it, then we're going to go to Rob Tabor or Tony Windsor. We also thought we could take him for a drive in electric car and just show him that, you know, new technologies exist and in regional areas these are really great. We'd be really conscious of the language we'd use and have our numbers really tight because his background as an accountant, I think he's really focused on the economies of things and not necessarily climate change because I don't think he has an open mind on that area at the moment. But yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much.